Recorded Books presents Diverse Energies, edited by Tobias S. Bakel and Joe Monti. Narrated by James Chen, Catherine Ho, Kurt Kanazawa, Shaun Taylor-Corbett, Neil Shah, Jasmin Walker, Nick Walther, and Roger Ye. Preface by Tobias S. Bakel. I grew up in the Caribbean, split between two worlds. I was son to a mother born in London, England, and a father who was born on a small island off Grenada. I looked white, but my father had an afro. Half of my family had a Grenadian dialect, my mom British. Some of my cousins were black, and my other cousins white. Who was I? I didn't struggle much with that where I grew up. In the Caribbean in which I grew up, there were Palestinian and Lebanese immigrants, Indian immigrants with last names such as Singh and Patel, European expats, mixed kids like me, and a wide range of other skin tones and ethnicities. But the books I read never looked like the world in which I lived. I read like a madman all throughout school, partly because I lived on a boat and we didn't have television. Books were my entertainment. I loved tales of fantasy, strange lands, strange worlds, strange futures, and adventure. And over time, I came to realize that most of the books I read had only one kind of hero, one kind of face on the cover. When I moved to America, I realized why. Most politicians had that kind of face. Most actors, most people in charge of businesses, most Americans. And as for my mixed identity, it confused a lot of people, but I've never been confused about it. I may fall in between the simple check boxes on a survey or in people's expectations, but as I traveled around, I found that there were a lot of people just like me. I write adventures about the future and of future worlds, and they're populated by a diverse set of characters. Why? It's the future face of the world. It's us, all of us. And we all deserve to be seen in the future, having adventures, setting foot on those strange new worlds. I wanted to see all the sides of my families in stories about the future, from my pale relatives to my dark-skinned ones. I wanted to see the whole human race. When I had the chance to create an anthology of stories, I wanted to bring that wide angle I grew up with to the page. The result, the futures you hold in this book, are varied. Some are fun, many are grim, but they are all diverse, full of energy, and hopefully they will all let you sample an energetic variety of some amazing authors who today are writing the books I had once hoped to see on the bookshelves when I was young and hungry for more heroes than just the ones I was given. The wave of the future is not the conquest of the world by a single dogmatic creed, but the liberation of the diverse energies of free nations and free men. John F. Kennedy.
The Last Day by Ellen O. Kenji watched his mother's careworn hands tremble as she ladled out the morning rice gruel. His 5-year-old sister, Tomoko, sat in unnatural stillness, her eyes locked on their mother's hands, as if sheer force of will would keep the precious grains from being spilled. A sudden commotion outside their apartment made them all jump. Kenji grabbed the wavering bowl from his mother's hands and placed it in front of Tomoko. His mother didn't notice the near disaster. All her attention was focused on their front door. Several wooden sandals clacked across the hallway floor, a shrill, strident voice dominating above all others. His mother shuddered before she faced him in anguish. He recognized the voice immediately. It belonged to Mrs. Ueda, chairwoman of the Women's Brigade, and she could be here for only one reason: to claim another child's life in the name of the Emperor. A year had passed since Mrs. Ueda's last visit to their building. A year since he'd hugged his last brother goodbye. Within the sudden, unnatural quiet of his kitchen, his family was as still as the statues of the guardian of children, Mizuko Jizo, that populated all the cemeteries, now more than ever before. Kenji didn't realize he'd been holding his breath until he heard the voice calling out for Mrs. Akita, their neighbor down the hall. He saw the tension deflate from his mother's shoulders and heard his little sister's soft, hiccuping sigh. Their ears were assaulted by the persistent knocking on their neighbor's door and the loud calls of Mrs. Ueda and her cronies. Tomoko slapped her hands over her ears and squeezed her eyes shut. Kenji's mother set down the wooden ladle with deliberate care before rising to her feet and shuffling to the door. Kenji watched as a tendril of steam curled up from a bowl that was not even half full. Swallowing down his hunger, he gave Tomoko a hug and pulled her hands away, motioning her to go ahead and eat. Unfolding himself from the table, he padded over to the door and placed a comforting hand on his mother's arm. She stared down at him blindly, her face a tragic reflection of the pained horror he felt himself. Moving next to her, he peered out the door and down the hallway, where three women in gray kimonos stood, their backs rigid with righteousness. After several more minutes of furious pounding, the door finally opened to reveal Mrs. Akita's frightened face. "Good morning, Akita-san. I am so proud and honored to announce that your youngest daughter, Michiko, has been selected to enlist in the Imperial Army of the Heavenly Father," Mrs. Ueda said. "I'm sure there's been some kind of mistake," Mrs. Akita's voice trembled down the hallway. "My daughter is only 14 years old. She's too young to join the army." "The Imperial Army never makes mistakes," Mrs. Ueda responded. "Didn't you hear the new decree that was issued earlier this week? The conscription age has been lowered to 14. Now we can send more of our young men and women to fight for our Heavenly Father and defeat his enemies." Kenji heard his mother's muffled gasp. Her cold fingertips gripped his hand. Only 2 more years before Mrs. Ueda would come knocking on their door for him, unless the Emperor lowered the conscription age again. And then, who would take care of his family? How would they survive?
"You can't take my only child. I've lost my husband and my 2 oldest to this war already. She's all I have left."
Mrs. Akita was weeping, trying to bar the women from entering her apartment. Kenji couldn't see Mrs. Ueda's face, but he had no problem imagining the crazed patriotic fever that shone in her eyes. He'd seen it in too many adults. How he hated her. Hated them all.
"If your daughter refuses to fight, she will be arrested and executed in the morning."
Mrs. Ueda's voice was smooth, devoid of all emotion. "Your family will be branded as traitors to the Empire. All your belongings will be confiscated and you will be homeless on the streets. It is your choice." There was no more resistance as the three women pushed past Mrs. Akita, leaving her to weep against the door. From inside the apartment, they could hear Michiko's frightened cries. Kenji guided his mother away. It took all his energy not to slam the door, not to run out into the hallway and punch Mrs. Ueda's smug face. He knew, like everyone else, that there was no choice. His mother stood leaning against the kitchen sink, her head bowed low. He hugged her tight, his arms wrapping completely around her frail form. He breathed in the light, sweet fragrance of cherry blossoms that always seemed to cling to her. In the last few years of the never-ending war, he'd seen his beautiful, vibrant mother fade in size, age, and happiness. Each year seemed to reduce her further, her back bowing under the burden of life. It was hard to pinpoint which had been the worst blow: the loss of his father's ship at sea, or the notices received on the same day of his 2 elder brothers' glorious deaths in separate battles. He'd been so proud that his brothers had been chosen as Tokkatai, so stupidly proud. Until his mother received their effects in small wooden boxes and their last letters filled with the regret of dreams never fulfilled. They were boys dreaming of becoming men, 16 and 18 years old. They died boys, who had never become men. A wave of bitterness threatened to overcome him. How foolish he'd been. They called it the highest honor to die for your emperor in a suicide attack against the enemy. Only now did Kenji realize that there was no honor in dying. Swallowing back his bitterness, he finished his meager breakfast and prepared to leave. His mother handed him a small bento box containing his lunch. He untied the wrapping cloth and opened the container, even as his mother begged him not to. Inside the small oval tin, he saw two small rice balls wrapped with a sliver of dried seaweed. Unsurprised, he looked up to catch Tomoko's glare of hungry resentment before she dropped her gaze. Her small face was narrow, nearly gaunt as she sat staring at the rice balls, hunger pinching her face tight even as her empty breakfast bowl sat before her. Kenji bit back his angry words, knowing his mother meant well. Taking the larger rice ball, he placed it in a bowl, ignoring the sudden increase of saliva in his mouth, the ever-present demon that ate away at his stomach.
Kenji,
his mother began. She faltered under his gaze. Her hand fluttered up to rub the side of her face, accentuating her collarbone and emaciated form. A desolate fury rose in him as he closed the lid to his bento box, tied it up, and threw it into his bag. Slinging the bag over his head, he ran out the door before he could change his mind. Outside, the heat of the August sun was already bringing up the early morning temperatures to a boil. Kenji lowered his dingy gray cap as he peered down the street.
Almost took off without you,
a husky voice said from behind.
We're going to be late to work if we don't hurry.
Kenji turned and smiled to see his best friend, Akira Tanaka, standing in the shade of the building next door. He was a sturdy boy, only a few months older than Kenji, and browned by the summer sun.
Sorry about that, Kenji said.
With a nod, Akira took off, with Kenji following close behind. Where are we going today?
Not too far,
Akira said, breaking into a thudding run. Kenji kept up, but found himself tiring after the seventh block. It was the lack of food. He wished he had even a fraction of Akira's energy and stamina, but his friend was eating better than most of the others. It was why Kenji had left home earlier and was following him instead of heading to work. The street seemed emptier than usual, but then again, it seemed there were fewer and fewer people around. Kenji had memories of streets crowded with people, holding his father's hand as they stopped at a local street vendor selling roasted sweet potatoes. He could remember the gravelly singing voice of the old vendor as he pulled out hot, dark, purple potatoes from his wood-burning stove. The flesh was soft and sweet, and so delicious. Kenji shook his head, dislodging the memory and returning to the present. No more street vendors selling tasty treats. No more laughing families strolling down to the park. It took 10 minutes to reach Akira's destination, a small mid-rise apartment building. They entered the dingy lobby area through the unlocked front door and quietly walked up the stairs. He followed Akira to the third floor and down a narrow hallway. They passed several doors until they reached an N unit. The sounds of apartment living could be heard through the thin, peeling walls, a baby's cry, the tinny voice of a radio announcer, muffled moans of pain or pleasure. With a quick look around, Akira pulled out a small chisel and shoved the narrow edge into the seam of the door, popping it open with one hard wrench. Kenji took an involuntary step back, hesitating for only a fraction of a moment before following his friend into the dark apartment. The stench of rotted food and general uncleanliness assaulted him. He pinched his nose tight and tried to keep from gagging as he followed Akira into the dirty kitchen. Several days of dishes, teacups, bowls, and pots were stacked all around the sink and countertop. A soggy rug sat in a pool of water that spread from a small icebox in the corner. Akira opened all the lower cabinets, grabbing tins and packages of food.
Quick, get out your bag, Akira called out to him. There's a small sack of rice that you can have.
Kenji's eyes pricked with the burning of tears at his friend's gesture. He grabbed the sack and felt it was more than half full, at least a kilo of rice left. Securing the twine on the top so not a precious grain would spill, he shoved the rice into his bag. The heavy weight was comforting. Akira was done with the kitchen, and he moved into the bedroom. Kenji followed cautiously behind him.
"Don't come in here," Akira said. "Remember what happened the last time you saw a dead body."
Shame warred with revulsion as Kenji swallowed down his bile. He risked a quick peek into the bedroom and could see the lower half of a still body lying on a futon. The curtains were closed, leaving the room in semi-darkness. His friend was poking through boxes and drawers, a thief of darkness, pocketing anything of value. Kenji took a hesitant step forward, his eyes drawn to the stillness of the feet. How strange, he thought. He is still wearing his socks.
"How did he die?"
he asked. Akira turned and looked at the dead body and shrugged.
"Not from hunger, that's for sure. He had 3 additional ration coupons. That's why he had so much rice, even though he was only one person."
"Then how?"
"He offed himself. Took a whole mess of pills. See?"
Akira kicked a few empty prescription bottles, sending them flying across the wooden floor.
"How long?" Kenji asked. "I've been keeping an eye on him for weeks now," Akira said, rummaging in a large trunk and appraising a small music box. "I can always tell who's checking out. Their feet drag, and they walk around in a daze, stop bathing, lose all interest in life. This one hadn't come out of his apartment for 3 days. I knew he was a goner."
Akira let out a snorting laugh.
"My uncle thinks it's unnatural, this knowledge I have. He said I must work for death himself. Hey, better to work for him than be taken by him, right?"
Staring at his friend, all Kenji could see was the flashing of Akira's teeth before he turned back into the shadows. Kenji suppressed a shudder. His friend had a talent, an unusual, terrible talent, but one that helped to keep them alive. Akira kept track of the loners, whether elderly or not, those unfortunate souls no one gave a damn about anymore. Scavenging on the dead had kept Akira and his family alive and had turned into a lucrative business. A shiny object caught Kenji's eye. On the floor, underneath a pile of papers, there was a flash of silver. He reached down and pulled out an engraved silver lighter. An intricate pattern of design swirled along its oblong shape. Running a finger over the cold surface, he had a vision of his father lighting a cigarette with a lighter very similar to the one in his hand. He could almost hear his mother complaining about the smell and shooing his grinning father out of the house. When they received his father's personal effects, the lighter had been missing, lost at sea, along with the entire ship. Opening the cap, he flicked the flint wheel, watching as a strong flame lit the room.
"Nice lighter," Akira said. "Silver. It would fetch a good price."
Kenji shut the lighter and curved his fingers possessively around it. It was selfish, but he didn't want to sell it. He didn't want to relinquish the small memory it gave him of his father. Akira stepped out of the shadows and eyed him for a moment before nodding.
"You should keep it. Lighters are very handy."
Kenji nodded and shoved it in his pocket, appreciating how his friend instinctively seemed to know how he felt. He owed him so much. With the deaths of Kenji's father and brothers, if it wasn't for Akira, Kenji didn't think his family would make it. It had been 2 weeks since Akira had called him for a hunt. 2 lean, hungry weeks. The comforting weight of the sack of rice was a burden he'd happily carry, even with the knowledge that it came at another's death. Several hours later, Kenji sweated under the steady blaze of the hot August sun. His shirt clung to his body as beads of sweat rolled off his hair and into his eyes. Many of his classmates had taken off their shirts, the sun beating down on their reddened backs. He worked side by side with Akira as they dug a new bomb shelter with 10 other boys behind the Mitsubishi weapons factory. Foreman Masahito an ex-soldier who'd lost a leg in battle, had already made his morning inspection rounds and was back in the cool interior of his office. The boys wouldn't see him again until lunchtime.
Aye, it's so hot I feel like a boiled noodle, Akita said. Let's take a break and go get a drink of water.
I hate this,
Kenji kicked at a clod of dirt. With a loud groan, Akita stretched his arms high over his head.
Well, look at the bright side. We don't have school anymore.
I liked school, Kenji replied. Akita sighed.
Sometimes I don't understand how we can be best friends.
Wiping the sweat from his forehead with a small white towel from his back pocket, Kenji walked with Akita into the dark, fortified concrete building for a respite from the heat. The old building had once been a thriving business center, with many offices and small shops. Now, it was a warren of abandoned spaces. They entered the nearest room, where they found another friend, June, sitting on a desktop despondently playing with a red metal yo-yo.
What's the matter with you?
Akita asked, nudging June with his elbow. The smaller boy sighed.
I just don't have any energy. What's the point of it all anyway?
Kenji nodded in sympathy. A truck drove by. Several large speakers were affixed to its roof, and a woman's voice blared out at them.
Hail to His Majesty the Emperor! Hail to the living God of Japan! We will win the war against the evil West. The Imperial Army will fight for the honor of our Emperor, our God. Long live the Tenno Heika!
Kenji thought it was funny how they all ignored the monotonous refrain that was meant to bolster their morale. All it did was increase their resentment at the Emperor's never-ending war.
I hate that stupid truck, Akita said. At least when it gave out food, we had something to look forward to.
June groaned.
Don't remind me. A nasty tin of tuna fish, hard biscuits, and a small container of rice. It wasn't even that good.
You wouldn't complain about it now, Akita said with a smirk. You'd be ripping that truck apart trying to get to the food, along with thousands of others.
Stop talking about food,
June shouted.
I swear I'm glad they lowered the conscription age. Only 2 more years, and we can start eating 3 meals a day.
Hopefully the war will be over by then, Kenji said.
The war will never be over,
Akita snarled.
Kenji shook his head. It has to end. We're dying out.
Akita stopped and stared at his friend.
What do you mean?
Kenji was staring out the grimy windows. It's been 15 years that we've been fighting the West. The Emperor can't hold out against them much longer.
Every year, things are getting worse. They keep dropping the conscription age because we're running out of soldiers to send into battle.
After the First World War had devastated most of Europe, Asia, and South America, the remaining powers had carved up the planet, claiming countries as if they were nothing more than pawns on a chessboard. Until finally, there were only 2 powers left. The President of the West and the Emperor of the East. But the worst part is that whole cities are disappearing and no one knows what's happened to them, Kenji said.
I know, it's the strangest thing, June cut in. My brother's squadron flew over Beijing last month. He wrote and said it was nothing like he'd ever seen. A whole city destroyed and empty. No people anywhere. What happened to them?
Akita scowled.
Whole cities can't disappear. It's just crazy rumors.
Kenji shook his head. It's not just rumors, Akita. We had cousins living in Manila who were supposed to come home last month. They've disappeared. And there's no radio contact with Manila at all. It's like they've been wiped off the face of the earth.
Damn it! That's just not possible!
Akita yelled.
Maybe they were bombed, and that's why they're all dead.
But what kind of bomb wipes out an entire city? Nobody has that kind of technology,
June said.
And where are the survivors?
His yo-yo twirled, forgotten on its string. What if cities are disappearing out there every day, and we don't even know about it? Kenji asked.
What if it happens to us?
They were all quiet. After a moment, Jun got up with a heavy sigh, winding up his yo-yo as he trudged back out into the sun. Kenji and Akira sat drinking water and fanning themselves, still too hot to move, when Akira bolted up in alarm.
Look, he pointed out the window. It's a B-29 bomber! Western!
He ran to the window and looked about wildly as Kenji dashed over to his side.
Huh, there's only one, Akira said. What the hell is it doing out there by itself? On a suicide mission?
He turned away with a heavy sigh.
I'm too hot and tired to care anymore.
Kenji remained at the window, staring at the plane.
Hey,
he said in excitement.
It's a parachute. Maybe the pilot had engine troubles and had to abandon his plane.
Akira looked toward where Kenji was pointing, but he was too late. The parachute had already dropped beyond their view.
I didn't see anything. Maybe it was the sun in your eyes, he said.
He stomped to the back of the room and sat on the floor, where it was dark and cool. Kenji watched his friend with amusement before turning back to the window. Suddenly, a bright flash of light filled the entire room, blinding him. He averted his face and closed his eyes, but the multicolored light was seared onto his eyeballs. In the next second, a thunderous blast threw him across the room. Clouds of dust floated everywhere, so thick Kenji couldn't breathe. He needed air, but he couldn't move. Opening his eyes, he felt the sting of 1,000 scorpion bites prickling his skin. Looking down, he saw shards of glass protruding from his arms and legs. His body began to tremble from shock as tears of fright coursed down his face.
Kenji, where are you?
He heard Akira shout for him, but the sound was muffled, as if he was underwater. Trying to stifle his fears, he called out to his friend.
Over here. I'm hurt.
From the corner of his eye, he caught a figure moving toward him, climbing over rubble. The air was thick with ash, floating particles, and something worse. He couldn't move, still stunned from the explosion. Akira cleared debris off Kenji's glass-covered body before pulling him up out of the rubble.
We have to get out of here, Akira said. They might come back and bomb us again.
Kenji began to pull the glass shards from his arms and legs as Akira looked on in horrified fascination.
Doesn't that hurt?
He asked. Shaking his head, Kenji concentrated on removing the worst of the pieces. There seemed to be no pain, even as blood oozed from his wounds. Pulling out the final piece, he looked at his friend. Other than a film of dust covering him, Akira looked unhurt.
What's the matter with your face? Akira asked. You're all red and burned on your right side.
I don't know, Kenji said, putting up a shaky hand to touch his numb cheek.
I can't feel anything. What about you? Are you hurt?
Akira shook his head.
My ears ache, but that's it. I guess I was lucky to be sitting in the back.
He let out a shaky breath that sounded on the verge of tears.
Let's get out of here.
Stepping out of the building, the boys were stunned by the sight before them. Bodies, burned beyond recognition, lay everywhere. Most were dead, but more frightening were the ones that moaned and wept, trembling in pain. At his feet, Kenji nearly stepped on the charred remains of a young boy, a red yo-yo still caught up within his blackened grip.
Jun,
Kenji whispered. He blinked back tears as he tried to swallow the scream building inside him. All around them, fire burned everything. People were rushing toward the river in a panic. Akira pulled Kenji with him into the crowd.
Wait, my family! I have to find them!
Kenji called to Akira. A group of soldiers ran by at that moment, herding people toward the hills and shouting out warnings of further attacks.
No, we have to keep going. It's not safe. They might come back any minute now.
Akira forcibly dragged Kenji away. Kenji resisted. Pulling away, he stopped a passing soldier.
Excuse me, sir. Could you please tell me if Urakamimachi got bombed?
Kenji asked. The soldier looked down with dead eyes.
Urakami is a burning inferno. The bomb dropped right on the cathedral. Nothing survived there. Save yourself and get the hell out of here.
Akita pulled Kenji away, and both boys began to run as fast as they could. They had not gotten far when a stabbing pain struck Kenji in his chest, slowing him down. Stopping, he pressed hot hands against swollen eyes, blurred with tears.
They can't be dead. They just can't. They just can't,
Kenji said over and over as his mind repelled the thought. Akita, noticing that his friend had fallen behind, ran back and, throwing Kenji's arm around his sturdy shoulders, dragged him up a nearby hillside. Reaching a patch of green, both boys collapsed to the ground. Suddenly, Akita cried out in horror. Kenji looked up in a daze to see a large patch of skin dangling from Akita's hand. It had ripped off Kenji's shoulder in a large sheet as his friend had helped him sit down. Horror-struck by what he had done, Akita began to cry.
Don't die, Kenji. We'll get out of here together. Please don't die.
Akita wept.
Water. I need water,
Kenji said. He was disoriented and had not felt the skin rip off his shoulder.
I'll get it. Stay here. Don't move.
Akita rose to his feet and rushed toward the river. From the hilltop, Kenji looked down on the area where the Mitsubishi factory had been.
Wake up, Kenji. You're having a nightmare, he thought.
But his eyes remained open, taking in the wasteland of piles of burning rubble and dying people. Monsters climbed up the hill, pleading for help. Hideous creatures, whose distorted humanity made them more frightening than any tales of demons and oni. Was this what had happened to his family? A young girl crawled up the hillside, half naked, but for the tattered remnants of her school uniform. The left side of her face was swollen and red like a balloon. The right side was blackened. The skin burned away. Her head was bald, but for small patches of wavy black hair that had once been long and luxurious. Catching sight of Kenji, she called out to him.
Is that you, Kenji-chan? I'm so happy to find you.
Reaching out a hand to touch Kenji's foot, she collapsed at his feet. Her entire frame shuddered one last time before stilling. Her eyes remained open and staring up at him. There was nothing about her he could recognize. Her face was a grotesque mask, and yet he grieved for her. It was as if she had held on until finding someone she knew, afraid to die alone. Akita appeared, a small can of water in his hand, which he gave to Kenji to drink.
Who was that?
He asked when he saw the body at Kenji's feet.
I don't know,
Kenji said after drinking down the precious water. But she knew me, he gasped.
She knew me. Come on, let's follow the train tracks. I hear there will be relief trains coming through if we can get to Michino-o Station, Akita said. But that's in Nagoya. I don't know if I can make it that far.
Kenji felt weak. Leaning over, he vomited up the water he had just swallowed.
It's less than 2 kilometers. You can make it. I'll help you. Please! We have to try or we'll die here.
Desperation sounded in Akita's voice. For his friend's sake, Kenji got up and began to walk down the hillside. He was lightheaded and confused. Had it been hours or days since the bomb had fallen? Only Akita's sturdy arm around him felt real. Everything else was a nightmare. They walked slowly, picking their way around downed utility lines, twisted steel girders, and pieces of broken buildings and houses. Roads were gone, and what would have been an easy route was now impassable, as dangerous live wires wreaked havoc, spreading fires through the ruins. Breathing became more and more difficult for Kenji. He felt as if a hot knife had stabbed him in his lungs. By late afternoon, Akita was practically dragging Kenji along.
Akita, leave me here to rest. I'm too tired. I can't make it,
Kenji said, falling to the ground. Akita stood in front of him, heaving with sweat.
No, I'm not leaving you,
We're going to make it. I see the train tracks up ahead. It's clear over there, so it'll be easier to walk. We'll make it, Akita said.
I can barely see anymore, and my face feels so hot. Please, just leave me here.
Kenji's face had swollen up so badly that when he touched it, he couldn't feel his own fingers. Peering up into Akita's face, he could make out his friend's scared but stubborn look.
Akita, he whispered, you know I'm dying. You know you can sense it.
No, I won't let you die, Akita said. I won't let you.
He leaned over and grabbed Kenji under his shoulder and began walking again. They followed the train tracks until they reached Michino-o Station in Nagoya. On the platform, already crowded with shell-shocked victims, the boys lay down in a small, dirty corner at the very end of the station, uncovered by a roof. As soon as Akita's head touched the floor, he fell into a deep sleep, exhausted by his ordeal. Kenji lay on his back, looking straight up at the darkening sky, so clear and cloudless. He couldn't see a lot, his eyes having closed to near slits. Every breath felt like a fire in his chest. All around him, he could hear the sound of suffering. Closing his eyes, he pictured his mother, her beautiful face smiling at him, until she morphed into a creature with melting skin. His chest was burning inside, pain tearing, ripping with every gasping breath. Through the thudding in his ears, he heard the sound of an approaching train. He saw Akita sit up and rub his eyes, wiping away the tears that had fallen as he slept. Without a word, he lifted Kenji to his feet and began to push a path for them toward the edge of the platform. Still, they were caught in the periphery. When the train arrived, they were shoved and jostled farther away from the door, until they found themselves behind the last car of the train. Kenji tripped and fell, taking Akita down with him. They were lost in a sea of bodies that was quickly leaving them behind.
Come on, Akita said. You have to get up.
People were climbing over them, frantic to get on the train. Akita covered Kenji's body with his, shoving the agitated mass away from them. As the crowd around them died down, Akita hauled Kenji up. He rushed forward, dragging Kenji with him, but came to an abrupt halt. His absolute stillness in the midst of chaos was frightening. Something's wrong, he said, starting to back away from the train, away from the people.
Where are we going?
Kenji asked, confused by his friend's actions. At that moment, he heard the train doors open, and all movement stopped. There was an uneasy silence, broken by gasps of horror.
What's going on?
Kenji asked. A harsh voice began shouting, but he couldn't make out what was being said. Then the sound of bullets filled the air, thousands of bullets ripping through flesh. Bodies fell before them, even as others turned to run away. Through the pandemonium, Kenji could see soldiers standing in every doorway of the train, spraying the crowd with their machine guns. Blood poured, red and thick, splattering in wide arcs. He watched as it pooled on the ground, wondering how he'd ever thought red a beautiful color.
What's wrong with them? The soldiers have gone crazy, Akita shouted.
Kenji shook his head. Akita was wrong. It wasn't the soldiers who were crazy. It was their world. He felt himself dragged across the pavement until he was stumbling onto his feet, held tightly around his waist by Akita. They ran behind the train, across the tracks and over the platform. He could hear the rapid fire of the machine guns and the never-ending screams. Kenji saw Akita point somewhere in front of them.
There's a drainage ditch with a tunnel over there. We have to make for it now, he said.
Kenji nodded and nearly fainted in agony as his friend pulled him into a crouch and ran for the tunnel. He couldn't see where they were going. He just put one foot in front of the other. He didn't want to live anymore, not in this world. All his family was gone. His city was destroyed. And now he knew that his people had suffered the ultimate betrayal by their emperor. But
He couldn't summon up the energy to hate him. He was too tired. They walked in semi-darkness, and the guns seemed muted. They stepped into something slick and wet. Kenji could smell old, stagnant water and the fouler stench of oil. He stumbled, falling onto his knees, one hand flung out to stop his fall. Akita pulled him up, keeping an arm around his waist. Kenji rubbed his hand on his shirt, trying to wipe off the waxy feel of the oil. They kept moving, their feet wet from the smelly water, as the tunnel got dimmer and dimmer. He didn't know how long they had traveled. At some point, his feet stopped working, and he let his friend drag him along. He no longer cared. All he wanted was to rest, to sleep, and never wake up again, to leave behind the hell his world had turned into. "This is what happened to them," Kenji said. "A bomb like nothing else in the world. A city killer." Next to him, he realized that Akita was crying.
"It's the most horrible thing I've ever seen. Who would invent such a terrible weapon?"
"They invented it to win the war," Kenji said.
"Then why haven't they won already? Why are we still fighting?" Akita asked.
"It's the Emperor," Kenji said. "The Emperor's army comes in afterward and cleans up the city so that no one can know the danger of the bomb. That's why there are no survivors."
"But why?"
Akita asked.
"Why kill us?"
"So that the war can continue," Kenji said. He remembered what his father had said so long ago. War was only good for governments and always bad for the people. If we knew about this bomb, people would revolt and stop fighting for the Emperor. He knew this as certainly as he knew he was dying. Only when we are all dead will the Emperor let us free, Kenji said. His breath became more and more labored. He could feel Akita's muscles straining under his weight, his pace unsteady and slowing.
"Don't say that. We're safe now. Don't worry. Everything will be all right," Akita said.
But Kenji didn't hear him. Instead, he heard the thudding of many footsteps echoing from behind them. The soldiers had found the tunnel. Akita was breathing harshly from having to carry him. Kenji knew he wasn't aware of the danger yet, and it was getting closer. He couldn't let his friend get caught. Akita was his best friend, the only person in the world Kenji loved as much as his own family. It would be his fault. He was the one slowing him down. A sudden shout behind them caused Akita to jump. Using the last of his strength, Kenji pulled away and fell against the wall, nearly sliding down the curved side. With a hard shove, he pushed his friend's hands away.
"Akita, do me a favor," Kenji said, battling for breath. "Leave me. Just leave me here and run and hide. Don't let them catch you. Don't let them kill you. You have to survive. Promise me that."
"I won't leave you,"
Akita said. "You must," he breathed. "You're strong. You can make it. Someone must remember what the Emperor is doing to us. Someone's gotta stop this war. You have to hide. Go to Urakami. The soldier said that's where the bomb dropped. No one survived. They won't think to look for survivors there. You'll be safe."
He could hear the footsteps louder than ever, the harsh calls of the soldiers shouting out commands, the rapid-fire spraying of bullets. They were too close. The pain that had been so overwhelming had suddenly faded, leaving Kenji with only one thought. He pushed Akita as hard as he could.
"Run, Akita! Run now, and don't look back!"
Turning from his best friend, Kenji stumbled away. He heard Akita's sobs, and then the splashing of water that receded into silence. All alone, in near darkness, Kenji continued to stagger toward the approaching footsteps.
his vision blurred, and his breathing was painful and shallow. Propping himself up against the wall, he fumbled in his pocket until his fingers curled around the silver cigarette lighter he'd found earlier that day. He pulled it out with trembling fingers, letting his palm wrap tightly around the oblong cylinder as he flicked open the lid. The soldiers were seconds away from him, but all he could think of was his friend running for his life. Kenji knew Akira had to survive, had to somehow spread the word of the Emperor's deceit. He placed his thumb on the flint wheel and pushed away from the wall. He stood in the middle of the tunnel, listening to the approach of the soldiers.
There he is! He's just a kid! Take him down! Take him down!
He didn't feel the bullets that ripped into his body. All his effort was concentrated on his thumb as it ignited the lighter. He saw the flame light up in his hand as his body fell backward. The sizzle of the oil erupted all around him. The screams of the soldiers brought a smile to his face. Akira was safe now. Closing his eyes, he could almost smell the fresh, light perfume of cherry blossoms in the air. Mother, he whispered. Mother, I'm coming. I'm coming home.
Freshies Frogurt by Daniel H. Wilson. A quote by Jeff Thompson.
It looks me right in the eyes, man. And I can tell that it's thinking like it's alive and pissed off.
A quote by Cormac Wallace, MIL, hashtag GHA217. Precursor virus plus 3 months. This interview was given to Oklahoma police officer Lonnie Wayne Blanton by a young fast food worker named Jeff Thompson during Thompson's stay at St. Francis Hospital. It is widely believed to be the first recorded incident of a robot malfunction occurring during the spread of the precursor virus that led to Zero Hour only 9 months later.
Howdy there, Jeff. I'm Officer Blanton. I'll be taking your statement about what happened at the store. To be honest, the crime scene was a mess. I'm counting on you to explain every detail so we can figure out why this happened. You think you can tell me?
Sure, officer. I can try. The first thing I noticed was a sound, like a hammer tapping on the glass of the front door. It was dark outside and bright inside, so I couldn't see what was making the noise. I'm in Freshie's Frogurt, elbow deep in a 20-quart SanaServe Frogurt machine, trying to pry out the churn bar from the very back and getting orange creamsicle all over my right shoulder. Just me and Felipe are there. Closing time is in like 5 minutes. I'm finally done mopping up all the sprinkles that get glued to the floor with ice cream. I've got a towel on the counter covered in the metal parts from inside the machine. Once I get them all out, I'm supposed to clean the pieces, cover them in lube, and put them back. Seriously, it's the grossest job ever. Felipe is in the back washing the cookie sheets. He has to let the sinks drain real slow or else they flood the floor drain and I have to go back in there and mop all over again. I've told that dude 100 times not to let the wash sinks drain all at once. Anyway, the tapping sound is real light. Tap, tap, tap. Then it stops. I watch as the door slowly cracks open and a padded gripper slips around the edge.
Is it unusual for a domestic robot to come into the store?
Nope. We're in Utica Square, man. Domestics come in and buy a Nilla Frogurt now and then. Usually they're buying for a rich person in the neighborhood. None of the other customers ever want to wait in line behind a robot, though, so it takes like 10 times longer than if the person just got off their ass and came in, but whatever. A big happy type of domestic comes in probably once a week with a pay pod inside its chest and its gripper out to hold a waffle cone.
What happens next?
Well, the gripper is moving weird. Normally, the domestics, like, do the same sort of pushing motion. They do this stupid, I am opening a door now shove, no matter what door they're standing in front of. That's why people are always pissed off if they get stuck behind a domestic while it's trying to get inside. It's way worse even than being stuck behind an old lady. But this big happy is different. The door cracks open and its gripper kind of sneaks around the edge and pats up and down the handle. I'm the only one who sees it because there's nobody else in the store and Felipe is in the back. It happens fast, but it looks to me like the robot is trying to feel out where the lock is at. Then the door swings open and the chimes ring. The domestic is about 5 feet tall and covered in a layer of thick, shiny blue plastic. It doesn't come all the way inside the store, though. Instead, it stands there in the doorway real still, and its head scans back and forth, checking out the whole room. The cheap tables and chairs, my counter with the towel on it, the ice cream freezers, me.
We looked up the registration plate on this machine and it checked out. Besides the scanning, was there anything else strange about the robot? Out of the ordinary?
The thing's got scuffs all over it, like it got hit by a car or had a fight or something. Maybe it was broken. It walks inside, then turns right around and locks the door. I pull my arm out of the Frogurt machine and just stare at the domestic robot with its creepy smiling face as it walks toward me. Then it reaches right over the counter with both grippers and grabs me by the shirt. It drags me over the counter, scattering pieces of the taken-apart Frogurt machine all over the floor. My shoulder slams into the cash register and I feel this sick crunching from inside. The thing fucking dislocated my shoulder in about 1 second. I scream for help, but friggin' Felipe doesn't hear me. He's got the dishes soaking in soapy water and is out smoking a J in the alley behind the store. I try my best to get away, kicking and struggling, but the grippers have closed in on my shirt like two pairs of pliers. And the bot's got more than my shirt. Once I'm over the counter, it pushes me into the ground. I hear my left collarbone snap. After that, it gets really hard to breathe. I let out another little scream, thinking, "You sound like an animal, Jeff, dude." But my weird little yell seems to get the thing's attention. I'm on my back and the domestic is looming over me, it's sure as hell not letting go of my shirt. The big happy leans over, its head blocking the fluorescent light on the ceiling. I blink away tears and look up at its frozen, grinning face. It looks me right in the eyes, man, and I can tell that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.